Good afternoon, everyone. I think we'll get started. It is my pleasure to have Roy C. Booth here at the Underground Theater in Duluth, Minnesota. I am Crystal Pelkey, the producing director, and I have known about your work for quite some time, so I'm very, very excited to talk to you and talk about your process. Mr. Booth was born in Bemidji, Minnesota. He is an author, poet, an essayist, and a scriptwriter. His 56 plays published. Goodness gracious, that's very amazing. Congratulations. And over 750 productions worldwide in 9 languages. In places, there's too many to list all of them, but just to give you an idea, Los Angeles, San Francisco, Seattle, Las Vegas, Houston, Minneapolis, Montreal, Ottawa, Edinburgh, London, Paris, Warsaw, and Tokyo. He's the author of The Flesh of Fallen Angels, and also The Horror, help me out here, Daphnis.
It's killer bones.
It's a good book.
He has directed, acted, and designed in over 200 theatrical productions. Welcome this afternoon. Thank you so much for being here. Now, there's so many things we could talk about and so many places to start, but how about you tell us about how you started? Tell us about growing up. Were you a creative child? What was your upbringing like?
Well, I wanted to be an author since age 6. My first writing experience, you know those little books you make in grade school where you fold them up and everyone writes about puppies and mom and flowers and whatnot? I did a 20-page comic book-like thing about myself and my dog going in a haunted house with a silver baseball bat fighting zombies, vampires, and werewolves. It went over very well with my peers. They thought it was great. My teacher, unfortunately, didn't think it was so nice, and my mother received a phone call the next day to have me arrange a meeting with the district psychologist, a counselor. And at that point, I knew I had something good going on. So I went and I do a little short story, but ironically enough, though, I had a really low reading level at that time. And I really started being able to read them all until I was about 8 years old or so, where I discovered comic books. And I started collecting comic books. And I found out that I don't read line-to-line per se, I read in blocks.
Fascinating.
Comic panels and comic strips or whatever. So, and now, hopefully I can tie that to my writing process later on.
Sure, absolutely.
Because I see things as more or less on the way of combo panels or potential items and so. And then I love my monster movies as a kid. I went to one of the classroom movies and all that, and they still refer to me as the monster guy. And that's what I mean. So, oh, they're writing something. I was interested in making films. I have the comic books. I own a comic book store now. I've been in business for about 20 years now, and we figured out that I own 300,000.
Oh my goodness.
And the store is like 100,000 on top, and then there's a floor level below, and that's my collection. And it's like 200,000 or something.
What kind of student were you? How was school for you if with your reading levels and your patterns?
I went to Pilger. No, I went to school in Pilger, Minnesota, which is K-12. And it's one of those small communities. Pilger is like a population of 289, 285 at the time. If you really didn't fit in the beginning, you really had ostracized. Was part of it. I basically made friends with all the new kids over the years. And so by the time the senior year rolled along, there was enough of us to hold our own. I was on popular per se in high school, but I had a lot of really good loyal friends, which I'm still friends with today.
Great. When did you know that you wanted to be a playwright? Did that happen in school? Was that after school?
Basically after school. I kind of fell in theater by accident. We needed a villain for our school play, Desperate Ambrose, my senior year. And I just auditioned for the fun, so to speak. I got the role. And I went nuts with it. It was a really liberating experience for me in that regard. And it going on the bus and having little kids go, I saw you in this great old road station, kick you in the shins. Thank you. So when I went to college, at Central Lakes College, then I was born in Community College, I decided I would work in the shop for what's that? Before I was going to do computers, I got a little boring, so I started working in the shop. The next thing I know, I'm auditioning for shows, and I'm stage managing shows, and all that sort of thing. So by the time I transferred, after I did my social arts degree at the University, I said, well, I was always going to be an English major, let's just add a theater minor. Well, that then turned to a theater major. Next thing you know, I'm running the shop. In the paint room. But I didn't write plays. I didn't start writing plays until after I took a year off from school, to go back to grad school, to do a master's degree in English. And while I was at Brinkton College prior, along the way, Karen Miller started a children's theater program. And what they got popular for, they would bus kids in to see the shows. So you do like maybe 5 days of performances, and then you do 3 shows during the day. Wonderful learning experience, and you know, do the show what's going on, that sort of thing. Well, I was talking to my firm instructor, Bob May, and he said, boy, I've got a problem. We decided to do an original play based on the makeup class, which is going to be really heavy in prosthetics. We want to do something with widgets. We don't know what to do. Do you want to help out? You know, and we've got time to kill them. I said, sure. So we got to do it. We came up with Beanie and the Bamboozling Book Machine. And the premise of the story is there's one young Beanie who doesn't like to read, but he's a mechanical whiz. So he makes a machine that reads books for him. This is like 1989. And the process of putting 3 books in, The Wizard of Oz, Smart and Southern Worlds, and Hansel and Gretel, there's a major malfunction, and you find out that these witches are actually real. They live in another world called Book World, and they get transported to our world. And it causes all a bunch of problems, and Beanie then has to find out how to put the witches back into their books. This is, he hasn't read the stories, he then calls up the other characters, like Dorothy, and Hansel, Gretel, ya-ya, and Hansel. And so Bob and I had a little fun with it because we needed, our theory was, well, even though we're busting kids and we see this, there's going to be some public performances where adults have more kids. So we were going to throw a few things in there so the adults enjoy the show too. Well, obviously, that's Witch Hazel and, you know, from Bugs Bunny, cartoons and whatnot. And we threw things in there from, you know, across this line, from Davy Crockett and across over. And then the person who played Beanie, Christopher Tibbetts, he got involved. We did him in the process, so he's on the first script. And you know, we did the play, it went over very well. It happened. But you know, we said, we're going to take this up, and we're going to send it to a publisher, get a nice rejection slip, and move on. And I said, well, let's just send it to Sam and French. You know, they're number one in the world. Why not? It would be nice if we put it on our walls. So look, we tried. That was it. We sent it out, and in 2 weeks, they got back to us and said they wanted it. Which is, well, as I've been doing this for the last, you know, 20-some years, usually they don't get back to us. It's like 3 to 6 months later.
Right.
So someone must have got that and just agreed with it right off the bat. So next thing I know, I'm going back to grad school, and I'm now a published playwright with Samuel French.